Welcome everyone, and welcome to this new lecture of the machine learning course of EPFL CS433. My name is Nicolas Flammarion, and today we will talk about the bias variance decomposition. So last time, we saw that it was possible to assess if a given function was a good predictor or not. And we also discussed how it was possible to choose the best out of a finite number of models. To do so, we saw that it was possible to bound the difference between the true risk of the function and the empirical risk. And this led us to the idea of splitting the data into a train set and a test set. We were learning with the train set, and then we were testing on the test set. And the main motivation for all this was the problem of the hyperparameter search. So for example, we saw that for ridge regression, it was possible to control the parametrization lambda in front of the regularization in order to control the model complexity. But we haven't investigated so far the role of the complexity of the class of the model. But if we really want to find the best function in our class, we will need to take into account this complexity. And this is what we will do today. So today, we will focus on how the risk, either the true risk or the empirical risk, behaves as a function of the complexity of the model class. And this will lead us to the important concept in machine learning of the bias-variance trade-off. And so it will help us when we are performing model selection to decide how complex and rich we should make our model. But just a small disclaimer, until now and in the previous lecture, we had derived quantitative tools. We have derived some tools which was possible to compute. Today, the analysis and the result will be more qualitative. It will be more conceptual. We will make room for interpretation. It will just to have a feeling of what is happening in practice. So let's start with a simple example. We will look at a one-dimensional regression problem. So we have a ground truth underlying function in blue we would like to recover. However, we are not directly observing this function. We are only observing some realization of this function at some point plus some noise. We are observing these orange points. And so in order to recover the ground truth function, only through this observation is orange, what we will do is that we will do a linear regression. But we won't only do a linear regression, we will do a linear regression using some polynomial feature expansion. So we will not only consider the feature x, but we will also consider x, x squared, x power 3, up to x power d. And the question will be really, what is the maximum degree D you want to consider? And you see that the maximum degree D really measures the complexity of the class. If D is small, you are only considering low degree polynomial and the class of function will be very simple. For example, if D is equal to one, it will only be linear function. And if D is very large, you will consider high degree polynomial and the class of function you will consider will be very complex. And so the question you want to solve is how far should you go? What is the maximum degree D you have to consider? So what we can observe is that if you take D to be small, for example, if we take D is equal to one, so we restrict ourselves to simple models, to linear function, then of course, no linear function will be a good predictor of this function because this function is non-linear, so it's not possible to represent with a linear function. So simple model will give you a bad fit on your data. It won't predict well the ground truth. On the other hand, if you are considering a very complex model, for example, a high degree polynomial of degree 12 here, you see that you obtain a model which is able to fit very well your data. You see that the training loss will be almost equal to zero. Okay. But you can directly see that in some sense, this model is overfitting to the data. You see that this prediction does not seem very right, does not seem very close to the good one. So what will happen? Why it is not a good idea? Why this prediction function is not very good to predict the true value, even if the training loss is very small? And so this is because, in fact, there is some randomness in the data. Previously, we were observing only one particular training set, but we could have observed a lot of different training sets, as you see in this animation. And even if you were fixing the same features xi, xn, but you will still have some variability in the output yi to yn. So you see that here I'm fixing the x, but still, if I observe newization of my distribution, I will have some new noise and I will observe new output y. So there is some randomness in the data. And so what is happening, in fact, is that the linear least square line I obtain by only fitting a linear model is relatively inflexible if I perturbate a lot, if I perturbate a little bit my training set. You see here in this animation, when I'm only changing slightly the output y of this point, the linear fit is not changing too much. Okay, so moving any single observation will likely cause only a small shift in the position of the line. And this is because, in some sense, this model is underfitting the training data. On the other hand, you see that for a very complex model, then it is really following the observation very closely. And so you see that you obtain some high variance, because if you are only slightly changing a point here, for example, this point, then your estimate F, your prediction function, will change considerably. You are really overfitting the data. And in order to overfit this data, each time you will change a little bit the training point, then your model will have to change a lot. And so we see that more if we are not only considering one experiment, we are not only considering the prediction we obtain by considering one training set, but we are considering the case where we are running the experiments with a lot of different training sets. So we are considering different training sets, and for each training set, we consider one prediction function. And then what we will do is that we will do the average of this prediction function. And so what we observe for simple model is that in average, all these functions will not predict very well. And you see in blue, this is exactly the average of all my linear fits in orange. And so you see that this average prediction does not fit well the data. This is what we call to have a large bias. But on the other hand, you see that the variance of the prediction is very small. You are doing some bad prediction, but this is consistently bad. For every new training set, I will get a realization, which is, I will get a prediction which is not too far away from the other one. And this is what we say, to have a small variance. The prediction, Fs, they have a very small variance. But if we now consider some very complex model, what do we see? We first see that in expectation, so if you are doing the average of all the prediction for all these predictors, so let me remind you, you are considering different training sets. For every training set, you learn a predictor, and then you are doing the average of all the prediction. And so what you see with very complex model, here polynomial of degree 9, is that the average is very close to the ground truth. You have done a very good job. The problem is that you are not predicting using the average. You are predicting using only one realization. You are predicting only using one training data in one training set. And so what you observe for a very complex model is that the prediction has a very high variance. Maybe in average, it is working well, but when you are looking only at one of this curve in orange, the true loss will be very large. So complex models have a small bias, but a very large variance. So in average, you are predicting very well, but you are not consistently predicting. And this is exactly what we want to study today. And so what you directly see with these two extreme examples of very simple model and very complex model is that what you have to do is to perfectly balance both the bias and the variance and to consider model with a middle complexity. So for example, a polynomial of degree 4, which will obtain a very good bias. In average, you are predicting very well. You are very close to your ground truth in blue. And you have a very few fluctuations. If you look at all this realization corresponding to all different training sets, they are very consistent. They are not too far away from each other. So let's try to understand this. So first we will consider a data model, okay? So what is a data model? The data model is that the output will be the true value perturbated by some noise. So what do we have? We have some input x, which follow a law d of x, which is fixed but unknown. And then we have a true model f, which is a function we want to learn. So this function is arbitrary. It is unknown, you don't know it, you want to recover it. And we are not assuming that the model is realizable. That means that the model is not realizable. And so what is the definition of this is that f is not in our model class. The function we will learn with our learning algorithm is not necessarily, f does not belong to the class of function we can learn with our learning algorithm. So we have some input x, we apply the function f, so we obtain this value f of x, but we are not directly observing f of x, we are observing f of x plus some noise. What are the assumptions we are assuming in the noise? The noise follows some distribution d epsilon, which is iid. Okay, for each new observation x, I will have a new noise, independent from the other one. And what is very important is that we are assuming that the noise is independent of the features x. Okay, so epsilon will be independent of x. And also we are assuming that the noise is zero mean. The expectation of the noise is equal to zero. And so this is giving you the output y. The output y is equal to f of x plus epsilon. So the output is a true model, f of x, perturbed by some noise, epsilon. And we will denote by d the joint distribution of x and y. And so for this data model, what we will do is that we will consider the square loss and we will come up with a decomposition of the true error for the square loss. And we will analyze this decomposition. So let me remind you that you have a training set S. So here the training set is called S, it's not called S-train, but it is really your training set. So I give you a data set S you will use for training. You have your regular learning algorithm A. It can be anything. It can be the least square. It can be some gradient descent. It can be some cost minimization algorithm. It's the typical learning algorithm. And using your learning algorithm A and your training set S, you will learn a prediction function FS. And what you want to understand today, what we are interested in is how the expected error of this prediction function you have learned using your training data, how this expected error behaves as a function of the train set S, and how it behaves at a function of the complexity of the model class. This is what we will try to solve today. So you look at the expected error. So let me remind you that the expected error, it is the expected error. It is exactly the error you will do when you are predicting fs of x, but the true value was y, and you are suffering the square loss of the two. And then you just take the average over all the x and the y possible, distributed accordingly to your distribution d. So this is the expected error. As we said last time, it is like a number which will tell you how good or how bad is your prediction. But you see here that this number, it is not exactly a number, it is a random variable, it is a random number, because it is depending on your random training set S. So for every training set, you compute a prediction function f of S. And for this prediction function, you compute the true error. And you want to look at how this true error is behaving as a function of the train set S. Okay, but in fact, we will not do it for the average over all the x, because the decomposition we will derive today will be true for every single point x. So what we will do is that we will, just to simplify the computation, we will fix an element x0, and we will look at the expected error I am suffering when I predict at the point x0. So this is what we will denote by L of fs. And you see that this is just the expectation over the noise, because the true error was the expectation over x and y, but here we are fixing x. And when I fix x, y is equal to f of x, zero plus some noise. So the only randomness comes from the noise. So the true expectation is exactly equivalent as considering this expectation over the noise of my observation. And if I would like to recover the true error for every x, I just have to take the expectation of this number over x0. And so you see that this L of fs is a random variable because it depends on the random training set S. So let's summarize. I have a fixed distribution D on my observation X and Y, and I have a fixed learning algorithm A. And I can sample some training data from D, I call it this data set S, and then I will give it to my algorithm A, and this algorithm is giving me a prediction. And now I am checking the performance of this prediction, not an average, but on a fixed data point x0. This is exactly this quantity. And so now what we are interested in is how this quantity differs if we run the experiment multiple times. We want to answer the following question: how consistently we will get the same result if we are running the experiment several times. So this is what we are doing. We are running multiple experiments. We do it the first time with the first random training set. I will get a prediction function f of s1. Then I will do it again with a new training set s2, and I will get a prediction function f of s2. I will do the same for a new training set, random training set s3, and I will get a prediction function f of s3 until s of sk, and I will get a prediction function f of sk. Okay, and so what we are interested in is really like the average and the variance of the prediction fs1 to f of sk over the multiple runs. If we are only getting the same result, then this result can be bad, but there will be no variance in our prediction. But on the other side, sometimes we get something which is really good, sometimes we get something which is really bad, then maybe in average your prediction will be good, but you will still suffer from a high variance, from a high variability of the prediction. So this is what we want to understand. how consistently you will predict if you are doing the experiment multiple times. So to do so, we will derive a decomposition of the risk L F of S, but not only for one random training set, we will take the average over all the training set S. So we will take the average over all the training set sample from D. So since we already say that the average loss L of F of S is equal to the expectation over the noise of the squared of F of X0 plus epsilon minus F of X0, you see that you can take only one expectation. So you will look at the expectation over S and epsilon of this quantity. So what does it mean? This quantity is really the average of the risk, the average of the loss you will suffer over all possible predictions. Okay, so this is your true risk. You have a function you have learned, f of s. How good or how bad are you predicting on a new observation, x, y, so how good or how bad are you predicting when you're observing a new noise? So this is this quantity. And now you want to see how this behaves when you take the average over all the possible training sets you could have considered. Because in order to learn this function, you have used only one training set. So now you want to see how the loss is behaving when you are taking the average over all the possible training sets. This will tell you how in average your method will behave for every possible training set. And so what we will do is that we will decompose this quantity in three non-negative terms. And it will be possible to provide an interpretation for each of these terms. So just to be clear, let's do it again. If you are considering only one training set S, you are using your learning algorithm to learn a function f of s. Then you can look at the expected error of this function, of this prediction function. So this will be the average loss you are suffering when you are using this prediction function to predict the value of a new point. Okay, so this is telling you how good is your predictor f of s. But this number depends on your training set S. And now you are taking the average over all the possible training set S you could have seen to see that how good or how bad you will predict if you were observing a new training set, if you were computing a new predictor using a new random training set. So let's do the decomposition. So we will only use the fact that it is a square loss. So this is a square loss. This is the loss between y, my observation, and fs of x0, my prediction. And now I will just expand the square very easily. So I will obtain three terms. I will obtain the expectation of epsilon squared. I will obtain a cross term, the expectation of epsilon times f of x0, my ground truth, minus my prediction, f of s, x0, plus the expectation of the squared of f of x0 minus my prediction, f of s, x0. You directly see here that I have been a little bit fast, that the expectation over s and epsilon here, it is only the expectation over epsilon because this epsilon is not depending on S, it is independent. So this expectation disappears. Here, I have the two expectations because this quantity is depending both on epsilon and S. And this quantity is only depending on S. So the expectation over epsilon has also disappeared. And what we will first do is to see that since the expectation of epsilon is equal to zero, the expectation of epsilon squared is exactly equal to the variance of epsilon. Because variance of epsilon, it is equal to the expectation of epsilon squared minus expectation of epsilon power two. And since expectation of epsilon is equal to zero, we get this equality. Expectation of epsilon squared is equal to the variance of the noise. Now we will also use the fact that epsilon, which corresponds to the noise of my new observation, is independent of my training set S, which is the data, which are the data I have used in order to learn my prediction F. So when I'm looking at the cross term, I'm looking at the expectation over S and epsilon of this product. What I can observe is that this epsilon is totally independent of S, and the difference between my ground truth F of X zero and my prediction F of S X zero, this difference is also totally independent of epsilon. So I can rewrite this as a product of expectation. This will be the expectation over epsilon of epsilon. It will be just the mean of epsilon. And this will be the expectation over my training set S of the difference between F of X zero and my prediction Fs X zero. Okay, here I really have crucially used the fact that epsilon and S are independent. Epsilon is the noise corresponding to my new observation on which I'm computing my expected error, and S is the training set I have used in order to learn my predictor F of S, and I'm doing the expectation over all the possible training sets I could have used. But both epsilon and S are independent, so when I'm computing the expectation over S and epsilon, I can split it in two, and here it will only depend on epsilon, and here it will only depend on S. And now what I will use, the fact that epsilon is zero mean. So this quantity is equal to zero, and so this product will be equal to zero. So the cross term is equal to zero. And so when I'm looking at the expectation of my true loss over all the possible training set, this will be equal to the variance of the noise plus the expectation of the squared of the difference between the ground truth F of X zero minus F of S X zero. And now we will try to study this term. So what is the trick? What we will do is that we will add and we will subtract some constant term. It will never change anything. You can always add and subtract something. And so what we will add and subtract, this is this constant. This is the expectation of F of S, X zero, but not of S, of S prime, where S prime is just like a second training set, which is independent from S. And I'm taking the expectation over S prime. So this is a number, this is the expected prediction, and you will add this number and subtract it. So what I want to compute is the expectation over my training set of the squared of the difference between my ground truth F of X zero and my prediction F of S X zero. And what I will do is that I will subtract this expectation and I will add this expectation. So I have done nothing here. I have just subtract a number and add a number. This is exactly, these two numbers are exactly the same. But now I can expand this square. So what I get? I get this first term squared plus this second term squared plus a cross term. and the expectation is over all this term. And now what we will do is that we will show that this cross term is equal to zero. So the cross term is equal to the expectation over my training set S of the product of two terms, of the product of the difference between my ground truth f of x0 minus the average expectation times my average prediction minus the prediction I have done when I used S. And so what do you see? You see that this term is totally independent of S. This is f of x0, my ground truth, minus the average of all the prediction I've done when I'm using S prime. So my average prediction is independent of this particular training set S. So this number, I can take it out of the expectation. Or if you prefer, you can take the expectation in. And so you get exactly this equation. So this number is equal to the difference between my ground truth and the expected prediction times the expectation over every training set S of the difference between the average prediction and the prediction function you have learned using S. And you see that this term, I already told you, is independent of S. And so you can take by linearity of the expectation inside, and you will get the difference between these two numbers. And now what it is important to be convinced is that these two numbers, they are exactly the same. This is the expected prediction you are doing on the point x0 when you are using the training set S prime. Okay, so this is a prediction. So you have a point x0, you are using a training set S prime to learn a prediction function f of S prime. You look at the prediction f S prime of x0, and you are taking the average over all the possible training set S prime. You see that this is exactly the same as this number. I'm considering a random training set. I learn my prediction function and I take the average prediction. The fact that here it is a S or here it is a S prime does not change anything. Both are the average prediction when S or S prime is a random training set. And so you see that this number and this number are exactly the same. And so the difference of these two are equal to zero. And so the cross term is also equal to zero. So we got that the expectation over my training set of the squared of the ground truth f of x0 minus my prediction fs of x0 is exactly equal to these two terms, which we will analyze soon. So what have we shown? We have shown that it was possible to decompose the expected true error, where the expectation is coming, is taking both on the training data set you use to learn your prediction function and the noise, okay? So this is the expectation over all the possible training set of my true loss. So this loss can be decomposed as a sum of three terms: the variance of the noise, the squared of the difference between the ground truth and my average prediction, and the variance of my prediction. So the first term is called the noise variance, the second term is called the bias term, and the last term is called the variance term. And what is very important is to note that these three terms are positive. A variance is always positive, this is a squared, so it is positive, and this is the expectation of a squared, so it is also positive. So my true loss, my average true loss, is equal to to the sum of three positive terms. So that means that all of this term is a lower bound on my true loss. Okay? Each of these terms always lower bound the true error. And this is exactly what we call the bias variance decomposition. And we will try to interpret it right now. Also, something which is important to note is that this first term is totally independent of your learning algorithm. So in order to find a method which will minimize your true loss, this is exactly what you want to do. You want to find a learning algorithm which will help you to learn a prediction function which will obtain a low true error. So in order to minimize this quantity, you will have to minimize the sum of this and this. So you will have to minimize simultaneously a low, I mean, you will have to minimize the bias and the variance. So you will have to find a method which achieves at the same time a low bias and a low variance. We will try to see if this is possible or not. So what is the first term we have? This is a noise term. And so the noise term is really giving you a strict lower bound on the error which is possible to achieve. Even if you knew the ground truth F, you will still suffer the noise. You can check this, that the loss, not of a random prediction F of S, but the loss of the true function is still equal to the expectation of the noise square. It is still equal to the variance of the noise. So even if you knew the true function F, you would still suffer from expectation of epsilon squared. And so the noise term really provides a strict lower bound on the error which is possible to achieve. Okay? And it is important to have in mind that it is not possible to predict the noise from the data because the noise is independent of the data set S. So when you are observing your training set, you will never be able to predict, to learn the noise of the model. So you will always suffer from this noise. Then the second term is a bias term. So what it is this bias term? It is the square difference between f of x0, which is the actual value of the ground truth, and the expectation over your training set of the prediction you have learned using this training set. So let me remind you, why do we have an expectation? Because you are using a random training set S to learn your prediction Fs of x0. And now you will consider your average prediction. You will do the average over all the possible training sets. Okay. So this is exactly the true value you would like to recover minus what you will get by doing the experiment repeatedly. Okay, so the bias kind of is telling you, if you are doing the experiment many times, do you get it right in average? So the bias really measures how far off, in general, the model's prediction are from the correct value. And so why is it called bias? So it is called bias because in some sense, it really refers to the error that is introduced by approximating a real life problem, which may be extremely complicated by a much simpler model. So for example, when you are doing linear regression, you're assuming that you have a linear relationship between the output y and the input x. But in real life, it is very unlikely that you have such a simple relationship. And so when you are performing linear regression to model some real life phenomena, you will get a bias in your estimate of the ground truth because you are using a too simple model. If the ground truth function is substantially nonlinear, no matter how many training observations you are using, no matter how many information you are using, it will not be possible to produce an accurate prediction using only linear regression. So we see, and this is exactly what we see in these pictures, is that linear regression will suffer from a high bias. Okay? Because the complexity is too small, and so it will not be possible to model this nonlinear behavior. So when I am considering the average of all this prediction, I get the blue line, and I will get a bad fit. So if the complexity of the model is small, then often you will suffer from a high bias. On the other hand, when you are considering a model which is more complex, which is more flexible, then it will be possible to fit very well your training data. And in average, you will get a very good prediction. So this is why, typically, when you look at the evolution of the bias in function of the model complexity, if you have a too simple model, then this model will not be able to get a good prediction for many points. Okay, so you will suffer from a high bias. But if you have something very rich, then you will be able to model some complex phenomena and you will have a low bias. But let me recall you, that's really something which is typical, and in practice, it will depend on the learning algorithm you will use. But for a lot of algorithms we will see during the course, this is the typical behavior you will observe. Simple model will suffer from a high bias, and high complexity model will have a very low bias. And it's important also to have in mind that in some sense, the training error can be treated as the amount of bias in the model. If the model is not able to fit the training data, then it's very unlikely that it will be possible to fit and to explain the ground truth. And so it's very likely if you have a low training error that you will have high bias. But here also, again, it is typical. It's not always true. Okay, so this was for the bias, which really, let me recall you, the bias term, it is the squared of the difference between the actual value f of x0 and the expected prediction. So it's telling you, in average, are you predicting well? And then the second term, it is a variance term. So the variance term is really like the variance of the random prediction. It is how close are all the different predictions you get by doing the experiments many times. Okay? So the variance really refers to the amount by which f of x0 will change if you estimate it using a different training data set. Okay? So what we have seen is that if a method has a high variance, so for example, for complex model, then only a slight change in the training data will result a very large change in the prediction function f. And this is exactly what we are observing with high complexity model. Okay, so in general, flexible statistical method will have a higher variance because I will be able to fit exactly all your training points. But then if you are just slightly changing one of these training points, then you will have to change a lot the shape of your prediction in order to still be correct on all the points. So this is what you are observing in this curve. All these orange curves are very different. Okay. So the prediction is very sensitive to the actual training data. In contrast, if you are considering low complexity model, you see that typically they will have a low variance because as we saw in the previous experiment, if you are just slightly moving one of the training points, then the curve, then the line will not be too much shift, okay? So typically, low complexity model has a low variance because moving any single observation will likely cause only a small shift in the position of your prediction. Okay, so kind of the general goal is that when you are increasing the complexity of your model, you will increase the variance also. So low complexity model will have a low variance and high complexity model will have a very high variance. So this was for the interpretation of these three terms, the noise term, the bias term, and the variance term. But what we saw was that the true error was equal to the sum of these three terms. And this is exactly the bias-variance trade-off. If I wanted to get the true error, I will have to do the sum of these three curves. And it will really give me something like this. So what we have seen, if the complexity is too low, then it's not possible to approximate well my problem and I will suffer from a high bias. If the complexity is too large, then I will have a problem with a very large variance and I will suffer from a high variance. And as a general rule, as you are using more flexible methods, the variance will increase and the bias will decrease. But what is important is the relative rate of change of these two quantities. Because this is what will determine whether the total true error, which is equal to the sum of these three terms, will increase or decrease. Okay, so in general, as you increase the complexity, the bias tends initially to decrease, and it tends to decrease faster than the variance is increasing. And so therefore, the sum of the bias and of the variance is first decreasing. And so therefore, the true error is first decreasing. However, after some point, increasing the complexity of your model has little impact of the bias. Okay, your model will be complex enough in order to model your ground truth, and so you can still add more flexibility, it will not help you. So the decrease of the bias will kind of saturate. But then you are adding too much in degree of freedom, so the variance will blow up, and at this point, the variance is increasing at a faster pace than the bias is decreasing. So after some time, when you are looking at the sum of the bias and of the variance, the true error starts to increase. Okay, so you see that we have a U-shaped curve when we look at the sum of the three. And the question will really be to find the sweet spot where the true error will be minimum. Okay, and this is really like the point with a perfect complexity. It will be rich enough in order to model your ground truth, but it will be not too rich so that you will not suffer from too much variance. And so this is what we call the bias-variance trade-off. And so what do we call it a trade-off? We call it a trade-off because it is really easy to find a predictor, to find a method with a high bias. With a very low variance, sorry. But we will get a high bias. For example, with a linear model, okay? So it's really easy to find a method with a very high bias and a low variance. You are just using a low degree polynomial. And on the opposite, it's really easy to find a method with a high variance and a low bias. You just use a high degree polynomial. But what is really challenging is to find a method for which both the bias and the variance are low. And this is exactly the bias-variance trade-off. And this is one of the main questions of the machine learning, and we will talk again about this question during the course. So this is an illustration of the previous example we have seen. If we are using functions which are too simple, for example, a linear function, then you will predict in average quite badly, but you will consistently predict badly. All your prediction will be equally bad. Now, if you are using a model which is too complex, then maybe in average you will predict very well. When you are doing the average of all this orange curve, you will obtain a very nice prediction. This will be very close to your ground truth in blue. But when you're only doing one realization, when you are using one training set S to learn your predictor, the error you will get can be quite bad. And why? It is because you are suffering from a very high variance in your prediction. And so what you have to do is you have to trade off between a low variance and a low bias by finding a model of average complexity, which is here a polynomial of degree 4, for which you have both a very small bias. You see that your average prediction is very good. It is very close to your ground truth, but you are also consistently predicting quite good. If you look at the different orange curve, which correspond to the prediction obtained using one training set. So I give you one training set, you learn one prediction function f of s, and you look at the prediction. This is exactly one of this orange curve. Then you see that here you will have a low variance. You will predict consistently good. Okay, so here you have exactly a model which obtains both a low bias and a low variance. Okay, and that's really like the challenge, which is to find such a method where you have both the variance and the bias, which are low. So to conclude, we can look at this nice illustration of the bias variance trade-off, which is really you have this target, and what you want is to be as close as possible from the center. Okay, so if you are at the center, you really have a zero risk. And the further away of the center you are, the higher is your risk. And you have four different cases. You can have a low variance or a high variance, and you can have a low bias or a high bias. So this is the best case. This is what we want. This is a trade-off you want to obtain. You want to have a low variance and a low bias. That means that if you look at the average of the prediction, it will be very close to the center. You will have no bias at all. And if you look at each prediction individually, you will predict consistently well. You will have something very consistent. You will have a low variance. Then we have another side of the spectrum, which is I have a high bias, but a low variance, which means that if I look at the average of my prediction, it will be bad, it will be far away from the center. But if I look at the variance, it is very consistent. This is not too much spread away. This corresponds to the case of low complexity model, okay, like a linear fit. I will fit badly my data. I will not really observe. I will not be able to explain my nonlinear behavior. I will have a high bias, but I will do it consistently, and we have a low variance. Then we have the case of a high variance, but a low bias. If I was able to do the average of all my different predictions, I will get something very good, very close to the center. Unfortunately, when I'm looking at individual prediction, it can be good, but it can be also quite bad. So in average, it is working well. I have a low bias, but all these realizations are very spread away. I have a large variance. And this is the case of the high complexity model. And here we have also like the worst of both worlds, which is have a high bias. If I'm doing the average, I will get something really bad. And on top of it, I have a high variance. This is not consistent at all. So that's the end for today's lecture. But as I told you, all these bias variance behavior were only typical and were really depending on the algorithm you were considering. For example, least square solver for a rich regression or other algorithm. And what is happening is that today we are kind of in a new regime with machine learning and deep learning, which is that in fact we have a paradox. We are learning with some model with a very high complexity. We are learning with model with neural network which are highly over-parameterized. So you have a lot of parameters, we will talk about it later during the course. But the complexity is really high. And this is what we call over-parameterized model because in fact, you have far more parameters than number of observations. And so for every training set, it will be possible to exactly fit your data. And this is what we call the model interpolation regime. And so in this regime where the complexity is very high, if we were applying what we learned today, what you will say is that, okay, I have something very complex, so the bias will be very small, but I will suffer from a very large variance. And so what you would expect from today's lecture is that the total risk, the true risk will be very high, will be here. But in fact, what you will observe in practice is that after some point, the true risk starts to decrease again. Okay? So in some sense, you have some very complex model class for which you have a very low bias, but also for which you have a very low variance. So what I wanted to say is that what we saw today was kind of in this regime, in the underparameterized regime, and was very typical of this regime, where low complexity model has a high bias and a low variance, but so a high test risk. High complexity model has a high variance and a low bias, so a high risk, and in between, you have to find a sweet spot. But it's also possible that for very, very complex model, then the variance start to decrease again, and even you can find a point here which will be lower than the risk. So you can find with some very, very complex model, a lower risk that your risk you will classically obtain. But here also, it is important to have in mind that it is not something which is general. It is not true for every model. It is not true for every learning algorithm, but it is typically what you will observe when you are training some very large neural network with one particular algorithm, which is gradient descent or stochastic gradient descent. And this double descent curve and also this related phenomenon of Benning overfitting, okay, where you are overfitting the training set, you see that your train risk is going to zero. So here you are exactly fitting your training data, but still you are generalizing very well. So this is why it is called Benning overfitting. And it is the object of intense research recently by a lot of groups. So if you are interested, you can look up at double descent curve and benign overfitting. Okay, so Thank you very much. I hope you have enjoyed the class, and I will see you next Tuesday, where we will talk about classification.